Thank you. Thank you. It's lovely to be here with you this evening, and I thank you all for coming. After President Lincoln issued his preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, three regiments of the Louisiana Native Guards were mustered into service in September, October, and November of 1862. The second regiment, made up of some free men of color, as well as men who, up until that point, had been slaves, was stationed off the coast of my hometown, Gulfport, Mississippi, on a barrier island. Ship Island is home to Fort Massachusetts, which during the Civil War was maintained as a prison for Confederate soldiers. They were the first officially sanctioned regiment of African American Union soldiers in the Civil War. Major Dumas, Francis Dumas, was one of the free men of color stationed there, an officer. He was the son of a white planter and a mulatto mother. When his father died, he'd inherited the plantation and its slaves. Though he was opposed to slavery, it was illegal in Louisiana to manumit. However, when black Union troops were mustered into service, he freed his slaves and encouraged those men of age to join the Native Guards. I used to go out to the fort every summer on the 4th of July to have a picnic with my grandmother and to swim. We'd always begin with a tour of the fort, and at no point did the National Park Service ranger mention anything about the black troops who were stationed there, only that the fort had been a prison for Confederate soldiers and that their names were recorded on the plaque at the fort's entrance. No Union soldiers, black or white, were memorialized there, though some of them had died and were buried there too. The speaker in the poem I'm going to read tonight is an imagined former slave to Major Dumas. The skirmishes and other historical details I mention are factual. The soldier who speaks has the duty to write letters home for invalid or illiterate Confederate soldiers, not unlike the work Walt Whitman did in the military hospital. He's also been given the task of writing letters home to the families of deceased soldiers. Thus, he is concerned with what is put down as record of events, of the past, of how we will recall and remember the events of the war. The cover of the book I'd like to show you has an image that is, I think, a perfect metaphor for our American story. It's a photograph of a page from the diary of Colonel Nathan Daniels, a Union officer. Because of the shortage of paper during the war, he confiscated the diary from the home of a Confederate and had to cross-write his own entries over it. In that way, it becomes a metaphor of our overlapping and intersecting narratives, North and South, black and white, slave and free. The poem begins with an epigraph from Frederick Douglass that reads, "If this war is to be forgotten, I ask in the name of all things sacred, what shall men remember?" Native Guard, November 1862. Truth be told, I do not want to forget anything of my former life, the landscape song of bondage, dirge in the river's throat where it churns into the gulf, wind in trees choked with vines. I thought to carry with me want of freedom, though I had been freed, remembrance, not constant recollection. Yes, I was born a slave at harvest time in the parish of Ascension. I've reached 33 with history of one younger inscribed upon my back. I now use ink to keep record, a closed book, not the lure of memory, flawed, changeful, that dulls the lash for the master, sharpens it for the slave. December 1862. For the slave, having a master sharpens the bend into work, the way the sergeant moves us now to perfect battalion drill, dress parade. Still, we're called supply units, not infantry, and so we dig trenches, haul burdens for the army, no less heavy than before. I heard the colonel call it nigger work. Half rations make our work familiar still. We take those things we need from the Confederates' abandoned homes. Salt, sugar, even this journal, near full with someone else's words, overlapped now, cross-hatched beneath mine, on every page, his story intersecting with my own. January 1863. Oh, how history intersects, my own birth upon a ship called the Northern Star, and I'm delivered into a new life, Fort Massachusetts, a great irony, both path and destination of freedom I'd not dared to travel. Here now I walk, ankle deep in sand, fly bitten, nearly smothered by heat, and yet I can look out upon the gulf and see the surf breaking, tossing the ships, the great gunboats bobbing on the water. And are we not the same? Slaves in the hands of the master, destiny. Night sky red with the promise of fortune, dawn pink as new flesh, healing, unfettered. January 1863. Today, dawn red as warning, unfettered supplies stacked on the beach at our landing, washed away in the storm that rose too fast, caught us unprepared. Later, as we worked, I joined in the low singing someone raised to pace us and felt a bond in labor I had not known. It was then a dark man removed his shirt, revealed the scars, cross-hatched like the lines in this journal, on his back. It was he who remarked at how the ropes cracked like whips on the sand, made us take note of the wild dance of a tent loosed by wind. We watched and learned, like any shrewd master, we know now to tie down what we will keep. February 1863. We know it is our duty now to keep white men as prisoners, rebel soldiers, would-be masters. We're all bondsmen here, each to the other. Freedom has gotten them captivity. For us, a conscription we have chosen, jailers to those who still would have us slaves. They are cautious, dreading the sight of us. Some neither read nor write, are laid too low, and have few words to send, but those I give them. Still, they are wary of a Negro writing, taking down letters. X binds them to the page, a mute symbol like the cross on a grave. I suspect they fear I'll listen, put something else down in ink. March 1863. I listen, put down in ink what I know they labor to say between silences too big for words, worry for beloveds. My dearest, how are you getting along? What has become of their small plots of land? Did you harvest enough food to put by? They long for the comfort of former lives. I see you as you were, waving goodbye. Some send photographs, a likeness in case the body can't return. Others dictate harsh facts of this war. The hot air carries the stench of limbs, rotten in the bone pit, flies swarm, a black cloud. We hunger, grow weak. When men die, we eat their share of hardtack. April 1863. When men die, we eat their share of hardtack, trying not to recall their hollow sockets, the worm stitch of their cheeks. Today we buried the last of our dead from Pascagoula and those who died retreating to our ship, white sailors in blue firing upon us, as if we were the enemy. I'd thought the fighting over, then watched a man fall beside me, knees first as in prayer, then another, his arms outstretched as if borne upon the cross. Smoke that rose from each gun seemed a soul departing. The colonel said, an unfortunate incident, said, their names shall deck the page of history. June, 1863. Some name shall deck the page of history as it is written on stone. Some will not. Yesterday, word came of colored troops dead on the battlefield at Port Hudson, how General Banks was heard to say, I have no dead there, and left them unclaimed. Last night, I dreamt their eyes still open, dim, clouded as the eyes of fish washed ashore, yet fixed, staring back at me. Still, more come today, eager to enlist, their bodies, haggard faces, gaunt limbs, bring news of the mainland. Starved, they suffer like our prisoners. Dying, they plead for what we do not have to give. Death makes equals of us all, a fair master. August, 1864. Dumas was a fair master to us all. He taught me to read and write. I was a man's servant, if not a man. At my work, I studied natural things, all manner of plants, birds I draw now in my book, wren, willet, egret, loon. Tending the gardens, I thought only to study live things, thought never to know so much about the dead. Now I tend Ship Island graves, mounds like dunes that shift and disappear. I record names, send home simple notes, not much more than how and when, an official duty. I'm told it's best to spare most detail, but I know there are things which must be accounted for. 1865. These are things which must be accounted for. Slaughter under the white flag of surrender, black massacre at Fort Pillow, our new name, the Corps d'Afrique, words that take the native from our claim, mossbacks and freedmen, exiles in their own homeland, the diseased, the maimed, every lost limb and what remains, phantom ache, memory haunting, an empty sleeve, the hog eaten at Gettysburg, unmarked in their graves, all the dead letters, unanswered, untold stories of those that time will render mute. Beneath battlefields, green again, the dead molder, a scaffolding of bone we tread upon, forgetting, truth be told. Thank you.